I love to build things. It's fun that you just have the freedom to build whatever you want.
Put on your hard hat and cinch up your tool belt for a groundbreaking BBS.
I'm excited about concrete and cranes.
As you explore a world of concrete and cranes, rivets and rebar, bulldozers and backhoes, you'll discover that skyscrapers aren't the only things that need a rock-solid foundation.
I would love to drive an excavator and dig in the ground.
During Blueprint Bible Study, stories of love, forgiveness, and resurrection pave the way to a faith built on Jesus, a faith built to last.
Wrecking balls are the best because they're big and they can smash a lot of things.
Every part of the day helps you uncover truth. You'll level up during games of Wrecking Ball Wreck. Crunch on delicious treats at Food Truck Snacks. Nail every project at Bulldozer Crafts. Make the ground shake at Jackhammer Music. Dig into the work of missionaries at Excavator Missions. And hit all the high notes at High Steel Worship Rally. All week, you'll hammer in on Philippians 1:6, which reveals God's plan for knowing you through Jesus, our strong foundation. Don't miss out on a groundbreaking summer. Join us at Concrete and Cranes VBS.
Blessing Church. If we have any guests here, we'd like you to take the cards out of the back of the pews and.
Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now?
All right, if we have any guests here, would you please take the cards out of the back of the pews and if you'll fill those out on your way out. You'll drop it at the stand in the front or through this door at the other desk. We have a gift for you there. The students are having a pancake fundraiser today, so whether you're hungry or not, if you could at least donate, I know they would appreciate that. We have a very important church meeting, church conference after the service next week. And we'd appreciate if we could have all members here because we'll be selecting those 10, we'll be nominating 10 who will select 5 out of those 10 for the pastor selection committee. Now we know that we've been blessed to have a strong pastor, and we're going to need to have you pray on this for those who will be nominated to select our next pastor. So if you'll pray on that, and like I say, if we can have everybody, all the members here, it'll be very important. And as you can see, Vacation Bible starts tomorrow. So and if there's anybody else here that would like to volunteer, please see Miss Patty or Miss Victoria or Miss Gwen. And at this time, if you'll join me in prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you for being in your house today. We know you're starting a new beginning, Lord, as we've had such a strong and spirit-filled leader, and now we must find a new one. We know, as Paul said, we must look ahead, Lord. Can't be concerned with the past. We pray for this committee, Lord, that you will guide them, that they will find the right questions, that they will find the right person who has our heart in mind, that has your word in mind, who follows the right procedures that you would want done. And we know this is not going to be an easy choice, Lord, but we pray for those who are selecting. We pray for those who have been nominated that they will follow what is your direction. We know, Lord, there are many sinners out there, and we need to have a strong church. We know that you gave visions to our previous pastor, Chris, and we pray that those those visions will come true, Lord, but it will take us another strong leader that you can bring to us. Only you can bring us to us, Lord. We thank you for your love and your grace and for all you do. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, church. I know it looks a little crazy up here, but we're still going to worship. So if y'all all stand up so we can go ahead and start.
I know a place where we can go to lay your troubles down, even your soul. I know a place where mercy flows. Take the stains, make you whiter than snow. Like a tide, it is rising up deep inside, a current that moves and makes you come alive. Living water that brings the dead to life. Oh, we're going down to the river, down to the river, down to the river to pray. Let's get washed by the water, washed by the water, and rise up in amazing grace. Let's go down, down, down to the river. Let's go down, down, down to the river.
Seen him move in my own life, took me from dusty roads into paradise. All of my dirt, all of my shame, drowned the stream that made me born again. Like a tide, it is rising up deep inside, a current that moves and makes you come alive. Living water that brings the dead to life. Oh,
we're going down to the river, down to the river, down to the river to pray. Let's get washed by the water, washed by the water, and rise up in amazing grace. Let's go down, down, down to the river.
Give a clap praise today. Hallelujah.
It's time to sing your song again.
singing today. You know this song. Come on.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul. I worship Your holy name.
He's so rich in love, sing it.
You're rich in love, and You're slow to anger. Your name is great, and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find.
To be thankful for today, church. We have so many things to give back praise to God for that we don't do during the week. We're here to praise Him and raise His name as He so mightily deserves. To bless the name of the Lord. Taken our pastor, and it's been an internal fight inside of me that I've had to fight for so many weeks, and today it came present in me a lot more than what I thought, and I've just had such a hardened heart because of this. And, you know, I've asked God for forgiveness from that, because he deserves so much more from us. And the understanding that Chris is in heaven, healed permanently with Jesus and God. And that's what we're all looking for at the end, is to be able to go home to our future home for our eternity. And that we have to expect those that we love to have completion of the things that they've done in their life, and be able to go up to heaven and be with God, just like we shall all be someday. And we have a future as a church, as long as we remain a community, because the church is never this building that's standing above us.
Amen.
It's every single one of us that have to hold hands and get through this in a mighty way. And this song is something that we need to be singing out to God in a mighty way today, because we need God. We need God. This next week is going to be a hard week, because there's a lot of decisions to be made that depend on how we worship God to continue on, even with the loss that we have, because there is no reason that we should not be giving worship to God on a daily basis, raising and praising and glorifying him, because he deserves it much more than we could probably ever give in our whole entire lifetimes. So I miss my brother, but I'm so looking forward to seeing him again in heaven. And I know the only way that I'm going to do that is to continue to fight here for Christ and for sharing the gospel. And I believe times like this allow that to happen. So I want you, I know everybody knows this song. I want you to sing this song with me, but I don't want you to sing it just with me. I want you to sing it to God, because he deserves all of our hearts when we praise him. Lord, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Come on, sing it with me, church. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. You're my
righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
Amen.
Good morning, Faymont family. I'm struggling. One, I have a frog in my throat. Two, I can't read the paper with my glasses on, and I can't see you guys with my glasses off. Can everyone hear me okay? Loud and clear in the back? Very important, or otherwise I'm going to hear about it after church. Okay. Today, for me, is a very special day. You know, we have those times in our life where we have special occasions, and we get to bring special people home to meet our family. And today, I have some special people here that have accepted an invitation to come home and meet my family, my Faymont family. And I'm grateful to have them here today. I have my extended family. I have Robert Preciado with me today, and he is a father figure in my family, and I'm gracious that he accepted the invitation to be here today. I also have my bestie, Nancy Paul. Wave, Nancy. Nancy is one of my best friends and a co-worker, and it's rare to have people that can work with you professionally and still love you socially. But Nancy, you have been a godsend to me over the past year. You have bared my burdens, comforted my tears. Been my confidant and my cheerleader, and supported me in more ways than I could ever thank you for. But thank you for being here today. And it's through my relationship with Nancy that I met my friend Vickie. And I met her several years ago. And let me tell you a little bit about Vickie. In the bulletin it says Vickie Burge. It's Vickie Burge. And that's my fault because I approved the bulletin. So I apologize, Vickie, for messing up your name. Vickie Burge is a partner in the law firm of Adams, Burge, and Bowman. She graduated from Wake Forest with a BA in 1982 and from Campbell University School of Law in 1985. She has been in private practice in Fayetteville since 1985. Her community involvement has included she's served on several boards in the community. She previously taught at FTCC, and she surrendered her life to Christ in 1971, most importantly. She is an active member of Village Baptist Church, where she has taught Sunday school for more than 30 years. She has served on numerous committees there, and if for many of you that may not know, Village Baptist Church is also without a pastor. Vickie has served on their pastor selection committee multiple times, as well as many other committees, and she has she continues to seek opportunities to serve the good news with others. She frequently speaks at various churches and women's conferences. During COVID, I sat in on her Sunday school class virtually, and on Thursday night I attend a Bible study virtually that Vickie leads. Vickie is not a pastor, but Vickie is a teacher. I can assure you of that. I have sought her counsel both professionally and personally, and everything that she has ever told me was in accordance with God's word. And so I know that she has something special to share with us today, and I hope you will all be blessed. Please welcome my friend, Vickie Burge.
now? It's about the same. I know I'm loud. I probably don't even need any help, right? So before we dive into the Word, because here's what I base my life on. Every answer that you and I will ever need is in the inerrant Word of God. And so before we dive into that this morning, join me as we pray. Father God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing to you. Speak to us, Lord, we ask. Prepare our hearts and our minds to hear from you. And may we be forever changed because we have spent this time with you. In Jesus' name, amen. I would be remiss if I didn't say thank you, praise team, for bringing us into the very throne room of God this morning. Because God inhabits the prayers and the praises of his people. Now, I want you to think about where you find yourself today as a church. God has a succession plan for you. As we look at his word, there are many times where we see leaders passing the baton of leadership to another man of God. Think about that just a minute. Give me some instances from the Bible where you see a leader of God passing leadership responsibility to another leader. Jesus to the church. Excellent. What else? Moses to Joshua. Is that what somebody said? That was a freebie because of the title of my little talk today. Elijah to Elisha. Excellent. David to Solomon. Good. How about a New Testament? Give me one out of the New Testament. Paul to Timothy. Yes, excellent. So as you think about this, you see evidence of what has happened before us. We are not the first church, and I'm going to talk about us because even though my membership is not at Faymount, I am a member of the church because we are the church, right? So we see how God has dealt with these transitions from one leader to another. And I want us to pick up and look at this passage in Numbers. You'll see in your bulletin that it is Numbers chapter 27. We're going to begin at verse 15, which gives us a period of transition from Moses to Joshua. And I want you to see what we can learn from this passage as we apply ourselves to God's succession plan for the church. Because as Beth mentioned, Village is in the same situation. Our pastor has resigned due to health issues, so we are also going to be searching. I understand Snyder's pastor has retired. Snyder is also going to be searching. So God is doing some shifting and shaking in Fayetteville, right? So let's see how we can be a part of God's plan, and I want you to take a look at this passage with me. Now, when we pick up with this passage, if you look over, and you don't have to turn there, but if you were to look over in Deuteronomy chapter 31, verses 1 to 3, through 3, you will see that when we pick up with what we're talking about today, Moses is 120 years old. And he says, I can no longer go out and come in. In other words, he realizes that his time is through. He has finished his service, and God is getting ready to call him home. He's going to bring him up to the mountain, and he's going to call him home. He says, and you will sleep with your ancestors. That's an example of how God explains to us the passage from this life to the next. And so as we pick up, remember that's how old Moses is, and Moses already has knowledge that he is not going to see the promised land. Well, let me rephrase that. He's not going to enter the promised land. He's going to see the promised land. Pick up at verse 15 with me. Then Moses spoke to the Lord, saying, may the Lord, the God of the spirits of all flesh, appoint a man over the congregation. Now let me say to you, first off, the first and most important step for this church or any church in seeking a new pastor is to seek the man that God has appointed. Think about this for just a minute. How long had God planned for Joshua to take Moses' place? Did it just happen when Moses says, hey, I'm too old to do this anymore, and God says, hey, you're not going into the promised land? Did it just happen then? Let me see your heads go like this. No. It happened before the foundations of the earth. And did God know that he was going to call Chris home when he did before the foundation of the earth? Yes. And does he have a man appointed already for you at this church? Yes. It is not the pastor's search committee to pick a man. It is the pastor's search committee's job to find the man that God has already picked. That should give you some peace of mind, right? Because he tells us right here, God is to appoint that man over the congregation. Notice, it's interesting to me, he uses a term for God here that we don't frequently see. He says, the God of the spirits of all flesh. Well, what does that mean? It means the God who has created all spirit, who has breathed life into the spirit, who's given knowledge to man. It means the God who is all-knowing and all-powerful. It is that God who has picked your man, just as he picked Joshua. Look what else we see here. It says, over the congregation, who will go out and come in before them, and who will lead them out and bring them in, so that the congregation of the Lord will not be like sheep which have no shepherd. So he tells us something else about what that man of God should look like. What should he look like? A shepherd. He should be a shepherd who leads the flock. Well, what does a shepherd look like? A shepherd looks like one who feeds his flock. Okay, and what is he going to feed you? The Word of God. He is going to be a man who believes in the inerrant Word of God and who stands on that Word of God. He is not going to be a man who comes into your pulpit to entertain you on Sunday mornings. If you come to church and you don't feel like your toes are getting stepped on, there is something wrong going on. Right? Because the Word of God convicts. It is like a mirror that we hold up to our face, and it shows us all our frailties. I don't know about you, but other women in here probably have to do this. I have to have a magnifying glass to put my makeup on now. I can't see how to do my makeup without my glasses on, right? Well, can I just tell you, when you hold that up to your face, it's a scary thing. Because it blows up all the little imperfections that you have. Well, guess what? That's what the Word of God says. It does that to us. It convicts us. So the man of God who comes here as a shepherd should be one who feeds you. He should be one who protects you. That is a man who prays over you, who encourages you, who lifts you up before the Lord, who speaks truth to you in love. That's what a shepherd does. A leader who has a vision, who that vision came not from the man but from God, right? And he works to further that vision for this church. A shepherd is one who gives his heart for his flock. I was always fascinated as I studied shepherds that at night they would bring their flock into an area that was probably bushes and limbs and maybe some rocks around, but there would be an opening. And the shepherd would sleep in that opening so that the flock could not go out without him knowing, and nothing could come in without him knowing. It is a man of God who protects his flock. In other words, he protects his pulpit. He doesn't allow guest speakers to come in here and speak the word who are not founded on the word. He does not want you to hear error. He wants everyone to be founded and standing upon the word of God. He protects you. He protects you from the outside and from the inside. So that's what this man of God would look like. But then, don't miss this, verse 18. So the Lord said to Moses, take Joshua the son of Nun, a man in whom is the Spirit, and lay your hands on him. Now, some of your translations may have Spirit capitalized. Does anybody have Spirit capitalized in your translation? There's one. Anybody else? Two, three, yep, mm-hmm. Some of you, thank you. Anybody, back, I see you. Anybody have Spirit in small cap? Anybody? Yep, okay. So the commentators, they just have a little disagreement about this. Because if Spirit is capitalized, who is it? The Holy Spirit, right? God's Spirit. If it's in the small cap, it means having a spirit of wisdom, a spirit of courage, all of those things that we see in leaders, right? A spirit of love. Well, all of those are fruits of what? The Spirit. So it's almost the same thing, isn't it? Because if you have the Holy Spirit, then you have the fruits of the Holy Spirit. So what is he saying here? Your man of God that he's already appointed should be full of the Holy Spirit. So let me just tell you this from serving on some other pastor search committees. We get these resumes in, and we look over these resumes, and some of these guys look really good on paper, really good. But when you watch them and listen to them, you're like, is this the same man? Is this the same guy? And, I mean, I remember one guy in particular that I thought, hey, this guy really looks good on paper. So I pull him up on video. The guy is dressed in all white with a pink shirt, pink socks, and white patent leather shoes, and he is dancing back and forth in front of the pulpit, and I could not even hear what he was saying because of all that was going on in front of the pulpit. And I thought, this would never do, right? So what I'm saying to you is, it's not about his education, although education is important. It's not all about his experience, although experience is important. It's not about whether he's married with children or married without children, although those things can be important. It's not about how old he is in numbers. It's about how old he is spiritually. It's about what he brings from his spirit to this church that matters. And when we look at this leader that God has set forth for the people of Israel, we see one that is full of the Spirit and evidencing the presence of the Spirit because of the spiritual gifts that come forth from him and those spiritual fruits. Got me? Yes? Watch what happens as we go further. We see that the Lord tells Moses to have Joshua stand before the priest and before all the congregation and commission him in their sight. You shall put some of your authority on him in order that all the congregation of the sons of Israel may obey him. Moreover, he shall stand before Eleazar the priest, who shall inquire of him by judgment of the Urim before the Lord. As his command, they shall go out, and at his command, they shall come in, both he and the sons of Israel with him, even all the congregation. As you look at that passage, what it says to us is, whomever this man of God is that comes and stands in this pulpit, all the congregation needs to support him, pray for him, encourage him. Was Joshua just like Moses? No. He was not just like Moses. Think about Moses. Moses is the one we study that's born and put in the little basket, right? Put in the river. Who rescues him? Pharaoh's daughter. So where is he raised? He's raised in the palace, in Pharaoh's family, treated as though he is the prince. Joshua, on the other hand, is born in Egypt in slavery. He is part of the Israelites that get led out of Egypt by Moses. He would have been there when the plague came on the tenth plague, when the death angel passed over. He was the eldest. He was one who was spared by God, by the death angel, by the blood passing over the lintel, right? He would have been there when he saw the Red Sea part. He would have wandered around in the desert. They were very different men. And why do I point that out to you? Because your next pastor is not going to be Chris Evans. And you should not compare him with Chris Evans. It will be hard not to. Been there, done that. But he will be a different man. And he will be the man that God has for you now. Those of you who are thinking about perhaps serving on the pastor search committee, let me speak to you just a little bit about that. Or maybe you have somebody in mind you'd like to nominate. ask yourself these questions. How responsible is this person? Is this person willing to commit the time, energy, and effort that will be required? We went through hundreds of resumes. The first pastor search committee I served on was when we were still at Village, and it took us almost 2 years to find the right man, the man that God had already picked. And this is how I know it was the man God picked, because we kept going back to the same one thinking it was him, and he kept saying no to us. I mean, how hard-headed were we, right? Duh. And then Dr. Martin came and served, and here's what I want you to think about. It is a time commitment. It is a commitment of your time and your energy and your willingness to be on your knees in prayer during that time if you serve. The other thing you need to ask yourself or ask about others is, will this person represent a diverse group from our church? In other words, it doesn't need to be all people of the same age. You need to have a representation of people. You want everybody to have a voice, right? Yes? They should, right? And quite frankly, you should not have people who are related by blood or marriage in this group, because that's not diverse, right? Sometimes it is. I'm laughing because sometimes it is. You shouldn't have someone who is paid staff on this group. You should have someone in this group who is a man or woman of prayer. Because again, if God has already picked this person, which I believe he has, it is your job to hear from God about who that person is. And the way we hear from God is through prayer. So this person or persons need to be spiritually mature. They need to be people of prayer. And here's a tough one. They need to be able to keep a confidence. Why do I say that? Because a lot of these men who will be submitting resumes to your church have not said one word to their own church about the fact that they were thinking about leaving. And you talk about a problem is when it gets back to their church that a pastor committee here is talking to them, life is very difficult for them. Here's the other thing. In keeping that confidence, this group of pastor search people need to be able to say to you who are not on the committee, we're working, keep praying. Because you who are not serving, you have a job too. Let me just tell you, that job involves your prayer, you being on your knees, that they will find the right man, the man that God has already picked. Your job is to encourage them. It is not to batter them. It is not to say, when you gonna get me a man for my pulpit? May I remind you, this is not my pulpit nor your pulpit. This is God's pulpit. And when God wants this pulpit filled, he will fill it. There are times when God delays in action because he is saying to his people, wait. You are to wait on me. Wait on the Lord, right? There is a period of transition that needs to take place here, and part of that is for you to grieve, but it is also for God to ordain everything that's going to need to happen for his man to come into this pulpit. And while we are waiting, we are still to be working. So you, congregation, listen to me. This is not the time to go check out other churches and hear other preachers. This is your time to be in your church working for your Lord in this community and being faithful to Faymont Baptist Church. Because the last thing we need to do is for the flock to scatter as though they have no shepherd. Because may I tell you, you have a shepherd. He is the good shepherd. His name is Jesus. And Jesus' name and Joshua's name, interestingly enough, means God delivers. He is salvation. And he is in charge. And the sooner we acknowledge that, the better off we all are, right? So understand that there is a lot that goes into calling a man to this pulpit. But what it really boils down to is getting our hearts right. I think about this as when Joshua takes over command, so to speak, of leadership of the Israelites, one of the first things he does is he calls them together. And he calls them to rededication to the Lord. For me, as I look at you and as I see our own church and as I think about what we face in this process, what I believe God is saying to you and to me is it's time for rededication. As Tony stood up here and poured out his heart this morning and said, I have had a hardened heart, many of us feel that way, and I'm sure many of you do. You don't understand why God called Chris home when he did. You don't understand why you're left without a pastor. You don't understand why there is struggle. God has a purpose in everything, and though we do not understand it, we must trust him. And it is a time for you and for me, our congregation, this congregation, to rededicate and commit ourselves to God. I think of it this way. I have to confess, I'm single. I've always been single, but I had a list. Any other single folks in the house? Yeah, okay. Have you had a list? Have you made a list of the qualities you'd like to see in your spouse? Come on. Anybody? No. How about some of you who are married who remember what it was like? Any of you make a list? Come on. Okay, there were lists. Thank you, thank you. Okay. Think about it this way. We made a list of what we wanted to see in qualities in our spouse. But the truth of the matter was, that list should have been for us. It should have been for what we would look like for our spouse. Does that make sense to you? Well, here's what I'm saying. While you're busy making your list for what your next pastor should look like, you flip that list and ask yourself, what does it look like in your list? Because we need to be working on me. I can't change that man of God, but I can change me, and I can be ready to receive what God sends to this pulpit. Good? So that's the challenge, I think, for us, isn't it? Where are our hearts? We've got to get our hearts ready for the next man of God, and that's hard. It's really hard when we love the one that was here, and we had no plans for him to leave. But God is working. I want you to remember, I love this. Charles Swindoll says, the key to fulfillment is involvement. If you feel that you're not being fulfilled in this church right now, and you have concerns about being fulfilled during this period of time when we are searching for a pastor here, then what's the answer? The answer is for you to be involved here at Faymont. Do your part. Because though you will not all serve on the selection committee, you will all be a part of the choice that is made. And it is all of us together who should be seeking God's will for this place. And just let me reiterate to you, I love this from Charles Stanley. He says, Spirit-filled leadership is the only leadership worth having. So if you don't hear anything else that I say to you today, make sure that the man of God that fills this pulpit is full of the Spirit. Let me also say one other thing. Do not fix your minds on a man of God to lead the church as it is today. What do I mean by that? God is not going to leave you where you are. He is moving his church forward because all the signs are ready. You see, I'm not looking for signs anymore. I'm listening for the trumpet. Our Jesus is coming back, and we need to be ready, and we need to have our communities ready. And Jesus is doing a shaking, I believe, because he is saying to you at Faymount, get ready. I'm taking you someplace. I want you to think in terms not just how the church looks today, but how the church might look, how it might look if all these pews were full and the lost people around this church building were all in here. That is what we need to have a vision for, is what God will do if we will be obedient and do our part. And so as you look for that man of God that he's chosen, it is my belief that he's going to bring a man in here who is not content to leave the church where it is today. Is that making sense to you? I think about this too. As I look over you, some of you are what I would call senior citizens. I've made it there myself. I think I officially arrived on Friday when I had another birthday. They just won't stop coming, will they? Think about this. Do not be tempted to say, this is a job for the younger people of the church. Moses was 120 years old. He was like 100 when he went up on Mount Sinai to get the tablets, right? God does not have provision for retirement in the Word of God, except for the priest, and last time I checked, none of us qualify for that. So here's the deal. It is a job for all of us. God will use this time to unify this congregation if you will allow him to do that. But each of you need to be a part of that unity. So I have a challenge for you as I close out today. I know that you're going to be selecting a committee. I saw that in the bulletin and I had heard about it. I want you to be in prayer about who those people are to be. It is not a popularity contest. You're not picking people who, you know, I used to joke and say, you know what, I know who the deacons are. They're the ones who were the ushers, because that's the only people the only men the people know, right? Have you ever experienced that? Lord, y'all haven't been in Baptist churches as long as I have. But what I'm saying to you is, search your hearts for the Word of God to speak to your hearts, for the Spirit within you to lead you to select those people who God would have on that committee. It is that committee that then will be charged with finding the man that God has already picked. And can I just tell you, there is a Joshua waiting. Let's go to God in prayer. Father God, I thank you for the time you've allowed us to have together. I thank you for your word and how you continue to amaze us as how you answer each of the situations in our lives. Today, Father, I pray for Faymount, this family of believers. I know that they continue to grieve, and I pray that you would comfort them, Father. I thank you for Chris and for his service here for his family. I pray that you would continue to wrap your loving arms around them, to let them know your presence, your love, like they've never experienced it before. I pray that as this congregation moves forward, they will always remember Chris as the Israelites, and even as we remember Moses. But I pray that you would direct them to the man of God that you have already chosen from the very foundation of the world for this next assignment. I pray that they would open their arms to him, that they would love him, that they would not compare him. But Father, I pray that they would follow his leadership, that he would be a man of the word, a man of the spirit, a man gifted in proclaiming your word. And I pray that you are going to bring about an amazing revival beginning in the hearts of these your people today. Help us to rededicate ourselves. Help us to commit to you, Father. We give you the praise and the glory and honor for all you're going to do in and through Faymount Baptist Church. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Thank you. to let everybody know Vickie will be standing at the back door if you would like to go and speak to her after the service. Of course, we do have the pancake meal after service, so anybody that wants pancakes, the youth are back there cooking them, got them ready to go. Please be in prayer and remember the Deacon Search Committee next week, called conference after the service. Please eat late breakfast, prepare for a late lunch. Please just try and be here, each and every member of our church. And with that, I would ask Tony Ratley, please close us in prayer.